Good morning.
Hey, why don't you stand together and say hello to each other? You want to anyway. You know you wanna. We serve a good God. Let's sing to Him. Seven, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord tell their story. Those He redeemed from the hand of the foe, those He gathered from the lands, from east and west, from north and south. Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and He delivered them from their distress. He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle. Let them give thanks to the Lord for His unfailing love and His wonderful deeds for mankind. For He satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Some sat in darkness, in utter darkness, prisoners suffering in iron chains, because they rebelled against God's commands and despised the plans of the Most High. So He subjected them to bitter labor. They stumbled, and there was no one to help. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and He saved them from their distress. He brought them out of the darkness, the utter darkness, and broke away their chains. Let them give thanks to the Lord for His unfailing love and His wonderful deeds for mankind. For He breaks down gates of bronze and cuts through bars of iron. Some became fools through their rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquity. They loathed all food and drew near the gates of death. They cried to the Lord in their trouble, and He saved them from their distress. He sent out His word and healed them. He rescued them from the grave. Let them give thanks to the Lord for His unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for mankind. Let them sacrifice thank offerings and tell of his works with songs of joy. There's more to this psalm, but I remember hearing about a mom one time who was trying to teach her son to read, and she read him half the book and then stop. Psalm 107. Read it when you get home.
place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, here in your love. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be.
God, you love us so much. It's a love that we can barely understand. We draw pictures for ourselves of the greatest love that we do know. And as deep as they are, as good as they are, they fall short. How can one God, the only God, give his only son to save everybody else? Everybody else. And we can't even figure out how many people that is. We only have statistical estimates of even how many people are in the world right now, let alone everybody that's ever lived. And how many people will live after us, just no idea. And for every cell of blood that Jesus spilled, another person is saved. And for every cell of blood that Jesus spilled, another person is offered eternal life. And for every cell of blood that Jesus spilled, another person rejects it. And for every cell of blood he spilled, another person never even hears. And yet, you loved us so much that while we were still sinners, you died for us. God, we love you. And you have taken this valuable, this precious, this treasure of love. You've offered it to us freely. And we are such human people that we found ways to even ignore that sometimes. Oh God, lift us up. Lift us up. Teach us, we pray. This magnificent, this unspeakable gift that you've given us. Teach us gratitude. Teach us the kind of generosity that only you can teach. Yeah, we bring gifts to you this morning, and we know this is nothing like what you did for us. And yet you delight in the gifts of your people, so we bring them, and we bring them joyfully, and we bring them as generously as we can. Dear God, please receive our gifts, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward to receive the offering, and Rachel has a ministry focus for us this morning.
There we go. Good morning. So I'm up here to say some really awesome things. First of all, today there's no Sunday school, but that's not the awesome part. The awesome part is that we're having brunch. So I hope that you want to stay around. I know I brought a French toast casserole, so if that sounds good, please stay. I don't know that I made enough for each and every one of you, but I'm sure we have plenty of food. So please stay for the fellowship brunch today in place of Sunday school. Now, I'd like to say the really cool part of this is that our Sunday schools are starting to bloom again. COVID really made it a hard thing for us to want to sit together really close and study the Word of God, but now we're seeing that Sunday schools are really starting to take off, and I praise God for that. Next week, we will be having something really different as far as Sunday schools when we start. We have two new Sunday schools starting, but the ones that are going on right now are so excited and really enjoying what they're doing that they're going to extend into our next session. So I just praise God for what's going on, that they want to keep going and keep fellowshipping together in the Word. So what I'd like to go over with you today is what's continuing and what we have that's new. So we will be having still, even though it will be moved, all three of the classes from last session. So we'll have Genesis with Jim Schompert. That will be moved in here to the sanctuary. The men's class, the Tony Evans No Excuses class, will continue, but they're going up to 306. And for what I hear, they're actually continuing for the full semester, or their full session, and having, once they're done with their study, they're going to have conversations about what they learned. Conflict resolution will be moving upstairs. That's Pam's class, Pam Jablonski's class. Conflict resolution has a couple more weeks, and they'll be moving up to 305 next week. But here's cool things, too. If I can turn my page. We have two new classes, and one of them is Reaching Out to the World, the forum. Over in 201, 202, Pastor Tim will be well, I think he's doing 1 week about his special ministry time. I think it was in Africa. I'm not sure. But that's why we need to go and find out. But each week over in 201, 202, we'll be having a different person speak on where they have gone and how the trip affected them and how they, you know, just details of how the Lord worked through their trips. So you want to keep an eye out for who's speaking. You can come to one class. You can come to all of them. But it will be a forum where you can learn about that. And in the Jericho Room, which is behind me, some people don't know where Jericho is. It's down this hallway. I think it's 203 or something. But Truth Filled by Ruth Chow Simons. It's a study of Colossians and how to preach to yourself the truth of God's word to help battle the troubles we're having in this world. It's a women's class. It will be taught by Emily Ayers and myself. And so you can sign up for that in the lobby because there's a book. But the rest of them, you can just go and join in on what God's doing in our church. So I hope that you want to join and keep learning. Take advantage of this morning where you can learn about God. And we just thank God for what he's doing. So Pastor Tim, if you wouldn't mind praying, I'd appreciate it.
Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for an opportunity for so many of our people here to exercise the gift you've given them of teaching, the expertise that you've instilled in them for different subjects, and for the hunger in your people to learn about you and about all the things that you have to show us. An infinite God trying to teach his finite people everything there is to know. Dear God, we'll never live that long, and so we thank you for eternity in which we can continue to learn. But in the meantime, we thank you for the practical things that we can pick up here from each other in conversations and discussions and from the teachers that you've anointed to speak to us. We just pray that you would help us to hear them and hear them well. In Jesus' name, amen. To begin with, I would apologize.
It ain't my fault.
We said that we would have books for you this week. As far as I know, they're still printing them. I don't have any idea. There were so many ordered that they are not here yet. And so they should have been here. Wednesday is Ash Wednesday, the beginning of Lent, and that's what this book is for. It's a Lent devotional. I would say grab one in the lobby, but you can't. So I hope that they do come next week and we'll be able to get them to you as soon as we can. It's called Amazing Grace because it is the 250th anniversary of that song, and I hope that you will get an awful lot of beautiful insights that are based around that theme. Speaking of themes, we are entering the Lenten season. The Lenten season is generally a little bit more serious than some other times of the year, and the sacred year especially. We confront the things that God has allowed us to face in this world. This year, for the Lenten season, I want to talk with you at length about a book that's very, very difficult, the book of Job. Many of you will have read it last year as you were stamping your passport, as you were getting your way through the Bible or certain parts of the Bible. No, the kids have to stay here for the book of Job, the whole thing. Wow, this is the first time in weeks I've forgotten that. Children, there's Children's Church going that way, CC Boom going that way, right out that door. Sorry about that, kids. You will have an opportunity to get payback on me, children. Miss Amy's going to tell you all about that. I hope that doesn't mean they'll dismiss me. The book of Job is a difficult book. It's a dark book. It's very serious. It's very sad in many ways. And
and confronts a subject that we really don't enjoy confronting, and that's the subject of suffering. If there is a subject that Christians may gravitate to a pagan view of, it might be suffering. Suffering touches us on such a visceral level. It's not something that's theoretical. It's immediate. It's personal. It's intense. Even seeing it from a distance, it's immediate, it's personal, and it's intense, and we don't like confronting it. And so when we talk about suffering as Christians, we are informing ourselves of what God has to say on the topic. And so we go to the book of Job, and you know the story of Job. Job, good man, very prosperous, and catastrophe befalls him when Satan comes to God and accuses Job. That's what Satan means, the accuser. Accuses Job of only being faithful to God because God has blessed him. And God said, so let's withdraw the blessings and see what happens. And God had faith in Job, that Job would continue to have faith in him. And so he allows Job to be afflicted with physical ailments. He allows his family to be destroyed. He allows his possessions to be taken away. And Job descends into darkness for the purpose of demonstrating the authenticity of his character. Of all people, doesn't righteous Job deserve the good things in life? Shouldn't suffering be reserved for the wicked? And so just to prove a point, seems to us to be such a small thing. How often does this sort of thing happen? Maybe even to people you know. Is that fair? In the thick of it, it doesn't matter what we know. What matters is how we feel. C.S. Lewis writes in The Problem of Pain, track with this. When pain is to be borne, a little courage helps more than much knowledge. A little human sympathy more than much courage. And the least tincture of the love of God more than all. And yet, what we know can help us, I think. It can condition us to address important thoughts in the thick of it if we prepare ourselves in advance. In ancient Egypt, the Book of the Dead described the process by which Anubis, the god of the underworld, would determine a person's eternal fate. He would take the person's heart and put it on the scales and weigh it against a feather. And if the person's heart was lighter than the feather, then they would have a good eternity. If their heart was heavier than the feather, well, then their heart would be eaten by Amit, the devourer of souls. We don't believe that. Just to clarify. And yet, how similar is that to the way we approach pain, the way we approach suffering? That says the person's heart, the person's goodness, the person's character should weigh somewhere in there. In other pagan worldviews, they see similar things, the concept of karma balancing out in a dualistic moral universe. It's human nature to expect that life will be fair. The youngest child expects that life will be fair once they know what fairness is. The dead person who has been good should rise to eternal life in our estimation. The dead person who was bad should be condemned. Take a look at Job's complaint in Job chapter 10, verses 1 through 3. I loathe my very life. He's undergoing this intense suffering. Therefore, I will give free rein to my complaint and speak out in the bitterness of my soul. I say to God, do not declare me guilty, but tell me what charges you have against me. Does it please you to oppress me, to spurn the work of your hands, while you smile on the plans of the wicked? And here's what he says later about the fate of the wicked. Why do the wicked live on, growing old and increasing in power? They see their children established around them, their offspring before their eyes. Their homes are safe and free from fear. The rod of God is not on them. This in spite of their open rebellion against God. To Job, the wicked enjoy the good things in life and don't see the terrible fate that should be theirs. At the same time, he protests that he doesn't deserve what he's getting. How many wrongs and sins have I committed, he asks. Show me my offense and my sin. Why do you hide your face and consider me your enemy? Will you torment a windblown leaf? Will you chase after dry chaff? Suffice it to say that one of the main messages, and each week as we go through the book of Job, we're not going to go through it verse by verse, but we're going to look at the larger themes in the book of Job. But suffice it to say that one of the central main messages of the book of Job is this. As unfair as it seems, good people will suffer. And it's no reflection on their goodness. Let me say it again. As unfair as it seems, good people will suffer, and it's no reflection on their goodness. We hate that. We don't expect it. Especially, we're in the middle of it. We're in the middle of it. We think, why is this happening to me? I didn't do anything to deserve this. Seems very backwards. I don't know how many times I've heard people who were suffering saying things like this. Why is God mad at me? What did I do to deserve this? Am I being tested? What did I do wrong? And even today, even now, people hearken back to the pagan idea that the experiences we have in this life are somehow in a spiritual balance. We think of God as if he were some petulant deity that we have to appease. And if he so chooses, he'll answer with his favor. It all depends on the offering we bring. It all depends on his mood at the time. Even the Bible seems to indicate that good things are a reward from God, and we know God judges the wicked. He says so very clearly. But human suffering in this life is not the ultimate expression of these truths. The Bible does indeed talk about the good things God has stored up for those who fear him, but the overall message of the Bible cautions us. Payday is not always on Friday. We don't necessarily see the good things of God when we'd like to, and sometimes they're reserved for heaven, not for this life at all. On the contrary, the Bible affirms with terrible honesty that good people will suffer. One of the very arresting portions of the book of Jeremiah is the whole chapter 45. Jeremiah didn't do his own handwriting. He dictated what he had to say to a secretary named Baruch. And Baruch was faithful. He wrote all this stuff down, faced danger, faced even the wrath of the king himself, and he thought that somehow he should get off the hook. Jerusalem was being sent into exile, and people were being persecuted, and the armies of Babylon were coming against him. And God says, no, everybody else is suffering. Why do you think you shouldn't have to suffer? But I'll make you this promise. Through all your suffering, you'll always escape with your life. The Beatitudes themselves affirm this truth. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. That word blessed in the Beatitudes could be translated happy. Happy are you when you're persecuted. You say, no, I'm not. Seems like a contradiction in terms, or at least a paradox. Jesus promises a reward for those who suffer well. And James follows this track in James chapter 1. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. James, I think you got that wrong. Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. James promises that our suffering is not pointless. We'd like to think that all the suffering involved for faithful Christians is related to being faithful, but it's not. I had a pastor when I was a child who preached that Jesus' message of turn the other cheek had to do with persecution. But whenever I looked at it later in life and started trying to read through it and understand what Jesus had to say, no, he wasn't saying anything about persecution at all. He was just saying, hey, when somebody slaps you, turn the other cheek. We're going to suffer. You as a faithful Christian can expect, to face the same sickness, tragedies, hardships, and struggles as everyone else. No more, no less, no exceptions. Just as God sends rain on the just and the unjust, misfortune goes both ways too. Solomon praises wisdom and condemns folly, and yet he says, with much wisdom comes much sorrow. The more knowledge, the more grief. That's an encouragement to enroll in college right away. Also, in this meaningless life of mine, I have seen both of these, a righteous man perishing in his righteousness and a wicked man living long in wickedness. So teach us, Job. Like you are the people of God, and you suffered. How do we make sense of this? Job is telling us something very important about the expectations that we should have in this life. And his lesson is affirmed by the rest of Scripture, and we overlook it to our own grief. In fact, I'd say we overlook it many times because we want to. It's a self-deception. It's wishful thinking. Good people cannot expect to be rewarded by God with less pain and more pleasure in this life. You thought being a Christian was going to be fun. It is. In fact, we can expect that pain is generally part of the human condition, and it often has nothing to do with righteousness or sin. And why is this important? Because in God's economy, motivation is central. Why do we do what we do? Do we follow God because we love Him and want to do what's right? Or do we follow Him expecting some advantage in our lives over other people? Do we pursue Him with the misguided pagan notion that if we do good things, we'll be rewarded with an easy life? While we believe and affirm the law of sowing and reaping, the Bible talks about it very clearly. We do not expect that reaping always happens at harvest time. It happens in God's time. And that may be in this life or the life to come, not in this life at all. Like with Baruch. In fact, sometimes doing good will result in persecution for the very thing that we might have expected to bring good things to us. When we live in these expectations, we set ourselves up for a crisis of faith. We think of God as being different than He is and expect Him to do things that He never promised to do. Of course, when we're confronted with the reality, it can throw us into a tailspin, make us want to throw away our faith. And you know, the ironic part is, this isn't as bad as it sounds. All our lives will be spent getting to know God, correcting the misconceptions that we have of Him. In the end, a life is still a finite and limited thing, and we will end our lives still with very much to learn about God, because He's infinite. He's limitless. If we truly want to follow God, then the tailspin can lead us to a place of a more realistic kind of faith, a faith based more accurately in who God actually is and what He actually does. And this will lead us directly headlong right into a second problem. Do we follow God because we think we know Him? Our knowledge of God, especially in the earlier seasons of our knowledge of Him, will be faulty. My knowledge of God is faulty. Yours is too. It can't help but be faulty because He's infinite and we're finite and He's not limited by time and we are. In the early seasons of our faith, we base our impressions of God on a couple of things: the testimonies of people that we hear and the books we read. Our own experiences, our own interpretations, all those experiences and our interpretations of them, and all these things are subject to mistakes. The world wants to tell us what God is like. And the biggest problem with that is that there's so much general disagreement about who God is to begin with. So when you get your theology from television or YouTube or wherever it is that you passively soak in your theology, from your friends, from the magazines you read, it's not going to be right. If we base our expectations on the impressions people have of God from a variety of sources, we'll be disappointed, especially since there are folks out there who will tell you that God wants you to be rich, to be trouble-free. There's folks out there who will preach that to you, and I'm here to tell you they're wrong. Anybody that's ever ministered in the third world knows that instinctively. Of course, that sign, the one that you see in the gift shops that says beer is evidence that God loves us and wants us to be happy, it's wrong. That's not, I'm just not even going to go into that. When we suffer, we'll be sent into a different kind of a tailspin if we buy all that stuff. We'll be subject to ideas such as, God isn't who I thought He was. How could a good God allow this? When in fact, the answer is right in front of us all along. God does allow suffering, and that doesn't diminish His goodness, but demonstrates His grace. Because He gave us free will, and we're free to pursue paths, even paths that bring on suffering ourselves. So this morning, this is a rather bleak message. I get that. Good people will suffer. Thanks so much, Pastor Tim. Now what? In Job's suffering, we see some responses that help us to know how to approach the problem when it gets personal. First, complain. Hey, you read the book of Job, you're going to see that. Complain! This is how you approach suffering. How many of you have trouble complaining when you're suffering? Complain to God. Not necessarily to other people, maybe to other people, but definitely complain to God. He's big enough to hear it. He's big enough to take it. I want to point something out here. The book of Job is poetic. If you have certain translations of the Bible, it's laid out in poetic form, and you can see it there. It's meant to reflect a man and his experience and the emotion it conveys. I can't help noting that the book of Job is laid out like a play, very much so. The prologue in Job chapter 1 and 2, Satan confronts God. In Job chapter 3 and 4, 3 through 14, act 1, the first cycle of speeches. One of Job's friends talks, Job talks. One of his friends talks, Job talks. So we call that a cycle of speeches. And then you have Act 2, chapters 15 to 24, another cycle of speeches. Act 3, guess what? Another cycle of speeches. Job chapter 25 to 28. Then we have this little interlude where Job pleads his case in chapters 29 to 31. And in 32 to 37, Act 4, Elihu, a fourth guy, steps up and he speaks along a different mode, a different vein of thinking. And then Act 5, the climax of the play, God speaks. And we're going to have a special message just about that one. God replies in chapters 38 to 41. And then the epilogue, Job chapter 42, Job is humbled and restored. I believe the book of Job represents a real man and his real suffering and restoration, but I believe it's rendered poetically as an exchange of challenges for artistic purposes. In that way, it's a little like Song of Solomon. It represents real people, it represents real situations, but under God's inspiration, it's rendered poetically to emphasize emotion. In the text, Job complains loudly to his friends. He's saying out loud for us to hear what's in his heart. I know myself. Sometimes I process most effectively out loud, and that's what I think Job is doing here. He's complaining to his friends, but mostly he's complaining to God. To Job, his suffering appears unjust. He sees himself as a righteous man, but his pain is unrelenting. It's intense, and it makes him wish for death. Job chapter 6, oh, that I might have my request that God would grant what I hope for, that God would be willing to crush me, to let loose his hand and cut off my life. Then I would still have this conclusion. And check out this conclusion, this beautiful conclusion. My joy in unrelenting pain. What? Job, what? That I had not denied the words of the Holy One. The pain is real, and it's not a sin to acknowledge that. If it's intense, it's not wrong to respond to that problem. Speaking the truth is never wrong. Expressing your perspective is not wrong as long as it's your perspective and not assumptions about God's perspective. Go ahead and complain to God. That's one of the things Job is teaching us. That's okay. In fact, it's productive. And ask questions. Ask questions, mostly of and about yourself. Job's questions come across like defensiveness sometimes, but the ultimate question is aimed not at God, but at himself. If I am guilty, woe to me. Even if I am innocent, I cannot lift my head, for I am full of shame and drowned in my affliction. Am I guilty? Am I innocent? Is there something in my life that needs to be weeded out? Am I being disciplined by God? Don't assume right off the get-go that there's nothing in your life that needs to be corrected. Maybe God is disciplining you. But don't assume either that He is. Explore. Test it. Complain to God and ask Him. I remember the story of a guy who... They had an altar call at a service, and a guy came forward, and he comes to the minister, and he says, I have a sin in my life, and I don't know what it is. And the guy said, well, what is it? He said, well, I told you, I don't know what it is. He said, guess! You got it right first time. Explore the option. Explore the possibility that there is something wrong in your life that needs to be weeded out. But don't assume it. In your complaints to God, ask the question, is there something I should be paying attention to? Job's questions come across like challenges to God, and I think that Job was leaning pretty hard in that direction, but his questions are honest searching. It's like he's trying to solve a puzzle or a math problem. He's trying to figure out what's going on, why it's going on. It doesn't make sense to him, but that doesn't mean there is no sense. And that brings us to our main piece of information about Job. His questions are asked with faith that there is an answer. And it brings us to a key thing about Job. Do not accuse God of wrongdoing. Job doesn't make the mistake that we often make when our emotions get the better of us during distress. He doesn't accuse God of being hateful or sinful. His wife said to him in Job chapter 2, "Are you still maintaining your integrity? Curse God and die." And he replied, "You're talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept good from God and not trouble?" In all this, Job did not sin in what he said. It's a key to the book of Job that we must read what he says with one piece of information intact, that he did not sin in what he said. It may appear to us at times that he ascribes some pretty awful things to God, but God sees the heart. And the biblical text is tempered with this truth. Whatever Job said out loud, his intentions were not sinful. Because of that, we have to interpret what Job says, giving him the benefit of the doubt always. We can read it and see lots of pain and resentment and even some hopelessness, but at the bottom of what he says is a root of faith. It's not wrong to ask. Look how Job describes God at one point. If it's a matter of strength, he is mighty. And if it's a matter of justice, who can challenge him? He believes God is just. So if there's a fault in play here, Job said, it's not God. So if there is one, maybe it's with me. But that doesn't make sense either, because Job knows he's a righteous man. And best he can tell, he hasn't done anything wrong. So he contents himself with complaining about his pain and trying to understand God. And what a great place to be, trying to understand God. And that's where we live in suffering. We do things wrong sometimes, and when we do, God has given us means for repentance, to return to Him. And we must do this. God is good. Our own hearts are right with Him, and therefore, something else is going on that's in the realm of God's righteousness. To God, and like Job, we wait. We cry out to God, speaking the truth and our own perspective, processing both reality and the truth of our God and our hearts. And processing will give rise to questions. And we can always ask God questions. But we ask not with despair at the end, but and we don't ask with doubt at the end. We ask in faith. And reach for the state of Job's mind and heart. My joy in unrelenting pain that I had not denied the words of the Holy One. We will wrestle with pain. We will wrestle with suffering. And like Job, we win through to the God of truth.
I invite you to stand with us.
See?
awesome truth that is. If you talk to me a little bit, you'll discover that I have many favorite scriptures. I don't have one favorite scripture. I have a whole bunch of them. One of my favorite scriptures is from Psalm 42 in verse 5. Why am I discouraged? Why is my heart so sad? I will put my hope in God. I will praise him again, my Savior and my God. And this scripture, you know, it's mentioned twice in Psalm 42 and then again in Psalm 43. There's definite emphasis going on here. David is said to be a man after God's own heart. And that's quite a nickname to have. In the psalm, we see he pours out his heart to God. And God uses him mightily, but David was not perfect. He made major mistakes. There's some encouragement in that. I make major mistakes sometimes. But did David ever get into a funk? I think probably he did, because he talks about feeling distant from God. In the beginning of Psalm 42, it says, as a deer longs for streams of water, so I long for you, O God. I thirst for you, the living God. Where can I go and stand before him? If a man after God's own heart can find himself feeling distant from the Lord, certainly we will at some point in our lives. The more crucial question is, what do we do about it? How do we get out of that when we feel that God is so far away? We're not there because we want to be. I'm not there because of action that I took, probably maybe inaction that I took. I lost my way for a short time. If I'm not following him absolutely, then probably I'm following something else. Maybe just my laziness. Maybe some kind of selfish desire. Something that's taking me distant in my relationship with God. Do you do that? Do you find that happening sometimes? How do we get out of it? This scripture says that it's a choice. Just a simple choice to choose him over something else. Then light can grow and darkness can fade. It doesn't have to be a groundbreaking, earth-shattering thing. Just a simple choice, a decision, a small step toward God. Again, why am I so discouraged? Why is my heart so sad? I will put my hope in God. I will praise him again, my Savior and my God. David is choosing to put his hope in God, to praise God, even though he feels far away from God. This isn't always easy, but when we're struggling and we feel far from God, it can be really hard, but it's really crucial to remember that God loves us. Thank him anyway. Praise him anyway. Hope in him anyway.
Joy, when my heart is heavy, all my he had lost everything in his life, Job fell to the ground and worshiped the Lord. He said, I was born naked, and I'll leave here naked. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name.
Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Go in his name. But before you leave, a reminder that we are having the brunch. I know Rachel did mention that, but I didn't want you to forget. Lots of food in there, and everyone is welcome to stay, whether you brought anything or not. Please come and help us fellowship and just rejoice in his presence. And then we would appreciate if conversation would also move to the lobby so that we can start setting up tables. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hello? Okay, there we go. Any help we can get? Just so you know, any help we can get?